Hey, what's up, garden friends?
Jeff here, Tropical Plant Party. How's everybody doing? I hope you're good. I am great. Fern Friday. Probably the last Fern Friday of the season. Kind of running out of ferns here. I have one other fern that I'm working on a video with, but I don't think that'll be ready till springtime. So I did want to go ahead and talk about a fern that's still a viable option for people to plant out in their yards. And this is the Autumn Brilliance fern. Really, it's the Autumn Fern variety. It's called Brilliance. This is the Dryopteris erythrosora, the Autumn Fern, the Brilliance Autumn Fern. These are a lovely semi-evergreen fern, hardy zones 4 through 9. Moderate grower, 18 to 24 inches tall, 18 to 24 inches wide. It's a low to medium light fern. They're pretty much always listed as shade to part sun. I've pushed a little bit further than that. We'll talk about that in a minute. And it's your typical fern. It likes moist, well-drained, organically rich soil. Okay, so why is this a noteworthy fern? Why do I like it so much? Well, one, it's beautiful. Now, these right here are freshly planted. So I'll talk about the planter a little bit more in a separate video that should be out next week. For now, just kind of want to get those ferns planted up so we could talk about them. The autumn ferns, particularly the Brilliance, that's the variety I have here in front of me. It's called the Brilliance autumn fern because it has like extra colorful foliage, mostly actually the fiddleheads. The fiddleheads being little curly pieces that come up and emerge out of the middle in the springtime or just as the fern's actively growing. Those tend to have a really vibrant reddish pink to even a coppery bronze color to them as they're emerging. And then the autumn fern aspect is because, well, oftentimes parts of the foliage has a nice shade to it as if it's going through fall color change. The ones I have right in front of me, there are three here in this planter, and they are not as colorful as they were when I got them. That's because I had them sitting in pretty intense sun. I always tend to push things a little bit with my plants, but I do that mostly because it's in a pot. They were in small pots, little nursery pots, still easy to move them around, and I just kind of kept bumping them up to more and more sun, and then I was like, okay, that's enough. They were pretty much in full sun. It's not great, but the temperatures weren't very hot, and we were having tons and tons and tons of rain, like to the point where I was actually worried about the ferns drowning, which is why I kept moving them into more light, because I was like, these need to dry out a little bit more quickly. Even as a fern, you know, you don't really want them to dry out necessarily, but like we were getting inches upon inches of rain in short amounts of time, so needed them to not be sopping wet. They don't want to be soggy. That's not good for them. But yeah, anyways, the result of that was a lot of the foliage became more green and lost some of that color to it, which I actually thought would have had the opposite effect. I would have thought the more light, the more pigmentation, as far as the bronzy hues that these ferns get on them, I thought there'd be more of that. Kind of like sometimes that's a form of like basically a self-defense a plant will have sometimes towards too much light, but no, instead it went away. But there's still some of it in there. You can still see there's some slight coppery tones and hues in there. It's very pretty. The autumn ferns, not just the Brilliance, I'm just going to talk about the autumn ferns in general. They're a moderate to, I think, kind of a fast grower as like fern terms go, but they're listed a lot of times as slow growers. I know others of you have talked to me about the autumn ferns and have said similar things. They're just a happy-go-lucky fern. They tend to pretty much be doing well no matter what. I mean, you need to stick to proper fern care, obviously. You don't want to stick it in like sandy or clay soil, burning sun on it. They won't like that. They want, you know, dappled light throughout the majority of the day, except for the morning with a moist, organically rich soil. One that isn't let to dry out for too terribly long. But the thing I love the most about them is that they're evergreen. I'm in zone 6. I'm like 6B, 6A, kind of right on the line. So they're like semi-evergreen here. But the only other evergreen ferns that I've ever grown in my area were like holly ferns, which are pretty, but they just have a different look to them. And they have not been as resilient for me as the autumn ferns have. I've had autumn ferns in pots before for up to like 3 years before I moved them into the ground, and they just kept growing. When temperatures would get really, really cold, sometimes there would be some dieback on them, which is fine. That's not a big deal. That's just them protecting themselves from the cold. But as soon as the spring temperatures came around, the fiddleheads just pop right up and they looked great. And when they don't maintain an evergreen state to them, you don't have to cut off the old foliage in the spring, which is kind of nice. When mine do stay evergreen, or mostly evergreen, in the springtime, as soon as the new growth starts to appear in the middle, that's when I go ahead and I cut out all the old foliage so it can just flush out with nice, new, healthy, fresh growth. Their fronds tend to have kind of a somewhat stiff appearance to them. They don't bend around too much in the wind or anything, kind of like an ostrich fern, or I guess I should say, like the antithesis to an ostrich fern, right? Who tend to be a little bit more delicate. Strong winds, heavy storms can really damage them. I mean, I guess the same could happen with these, but that's never been an issue with mine. They're usually pretty sturdy. I mean, I had this planter sit on the ground a little while ago in my lab. My Labrador went walking past and his tail just went nuts on the plant. And it's still holding up okay. An ostrich fern would have been shredded to pieces. Not that those are the only two fern options, but typically, as perennials, I mostly grow the ostrich ferns and then these autumn ferns. And that's because those are, in my opinion, pretty much the easiest ones to grow. I don't have to fuss with them very much. With my ferns, in the springtime, when the new growth starts to appear, I go in around the root ball on the surface of the soil, and I start amending in usually some Espoma biotone starter and some fresh composty material, whether that's like manure, earthworm castings, just compost, just rich material. Because think about where ferns grow, right? They tend to grow in heavily wooded areas where there's a lot of leaf litter and debris and organics breaking down the soil surface, and it's a nice loose airy mix that they're growing in. So I like to mimic that as much as possible, and that's why I've never really used chemical fertilizers on my ferns. I guess I've used like seaweed fertilizer before and things kind of that nature, but otherwise I mostly just make sure the soil's nice and rich for them. And then, like I said, like the plant tone, Espoma biotone starter, anything equivalent to that, something that just has materials in it that's going to enrich the soil and encourage the growth of the good bacteria and the good fungus around those roots to help the breakdown of organics and release nitrogen and other things that'll help keep the plant growing. Got a little bit specific there, but I have had people ask me about what I fertilize my ferns with, and that's just kind of the best answer. I really just try and keep the soil really healthy and active around my ferns. Active meaning like biologically active. That's what I mean. Oh, and these are still little too. They get to be a decent size. I mean, it's not a huge fern. They have a more of a wide growth than a tall growth, but well, really it's a fairly even growth, I should say. It's a growth that, you know, makes sense. Like you have your cinnamon ferns that just go whoop straight up and down, kind of spread out a little bit. Same thing with ostrich ferns. These come up and have kind of a circular growth habit to them. And that's one of the other things I really like about them. That's, I mean, a really typical fern characteristic, but I don't see it as often in ferns that I can grow in my hot climate. The winters are frigid, but the summers, very toasty. So that's why I like these autumn ferns. They're nice and tough and sturdy. They don't usually skip a beat. Sometimes they can struggle a little bit when we start to hit triple digit temperatures, but I can say that about pretty much all of my plants, even the palm trees. Like, they don't really like to be that hot. So each one of the ferns in here, these are small, maybe, I don't know, a foot by a foot. They will double that size easily. Next year, they should be much, much, much bigger. The fronds themselves will stand up much higher, and they'll have more of an airy appearance to them. And they should be more colorful, too. Typically, these divide up just fine through division. Just take some root cuttings or dig up some root divisions, that is. Probably in the spring, once they've started to grow a little bit, go ahead and divide them up, spread them around. Doesn't have to be done too terribly often. They will have a fairly tight growth habit to them, but they're not going to fill out and take over an area like an ostrich fern would, or even cinnamon ferns, a lot of those other more upright types ferns like the osmundums. I think these look really nice when they're landscaped around some rocks and things like that, or they can be planted up as a border. They only get 24 inches tall, so look great in the front of a nice shady garden, or maybe throw it in a container. There's your sneak peek. That's it though, back to the up closes, you know what I'm saying. They're versatile, that's the point. And resilient. Versatile and resilient, those are the characteristics that I will always find the most endearing in any fern. Now, could you grow it as a houseplant? Sure, I don't really see why not. That's been asked on some of my other fern videos. I'm talking about more ferns you keep outside, but it's gonna be the same struggle that's with any other indoor fern, which is maintaining high levels of humidity, and you're going to want some airflow in there to help prevent bugs and things like that from infesting the plant. When you have a moist plant, you tend to have a lot of issues with things like fungus, gnats, and whatnot. And having good airflow and high humidity sometimes are tricky things to pull off in like the typical household setting. But you could give it a try. It's an evergreen fern, so it's not necessarily one that needs a chill or a dieback or a dormancy, anything like that. Go ahead and give it a shot. Maybe someone out there who's watching has done it before. Let me know. Oh, and then on to the lighting thing. So the only reason I was able to move these into more sun is because I've grown these autumn ferns many times, and I know, at least in my climate and my backyard, the way I grow my plants, meaning like the way they're watered and cared for, I know they can take a lot more sun than your typical shade-loving fern. That's not something I would do with a fern I've never grown before. It would be very risky. But the autumn ferns, even though shade to part sun, I've pushed them into full sun before, and they were okay. Probably not a great idea, though. It kind of happened. There is a tree above them that a storm took out, so they ended up getting full sun, and they did okay with it. But they did crisp up, and there was some bad-looking foliage after some heat spells, so losing that afternoon shade did impact them quite a bit. It didn't kill them, though. But I will be keeping these ferns specifically in a spot where they're going to get several hours, or 4 to 5 hours, probably, of morning sun. Then it's going to be filtered light throughout the rest of the day. And actually, they're going to be going under my maple tree, so it'll be almost dark in the afternoon. Not as much filtered. It's like really dark under that tree. It's going to lose its leaves though here in a couple of months. When that happens, I will move it because the winter sun is going to be too much for them. I'll only want these ferns to get like a little bit of morning sun during the winter time, and I want that filtered and shaded throughout the rest of the day in the winter. The winter sun is strong. Really strong. It'll burn things to a crisp, especially if there's snow on the ground, because then there's a lot of reflecting the light back on top of them. Snow's a good insulator, so don't really worry about snow or anything killing them back. That's not an issue, but it's very windy here. Dry, strong wind in the wintertime combined with intense sun, not great for a fern. So that's one of the reasons these are in a pot, so that I can move them as needed. That's why it's always kind of a nice idea when you're planning out your garden to maybe throw in a couple of evergreen trees, if possible. So that way you have a place to plant shade-loving evergreens that normally would be burned to a crisp once the leaves fall off of the deciduous tree. Okay, that's all. It's a neat fern. This is kind of a fern appreciation, but it's Fern Friday, so I want everybody talking about the fern. What are your experiences with the autumn fern, the Brilliance variety, any variety? It doesn't really matter. I know a lot of y'all out there are growing it. It's a really common, popular fern because it's a really sturdy and tough fern. That's one of the reasons. But yeah, tell me about your ferns. Oh goodness, I'm going to wrap this up before that leaf blower gets over here. This person, oh my goodness, when that leaf blower is going, they never stop. Yeah, comment down below. Let me know about your ferns and just say hi. I love talking to everybody. I have all my social media linked down below in the description of the video. I use Instagram way, way, way more than anything else. That's the best place to find me, probably. And if you haven't already and you'd like to, you can give the video a thumbs up. It makes a big difference for the videos and for the channel, so thank you. I appreciate it. And subscribe as well and hit that notification bell. Upload multiple times a week, and that way you'll know new videos come out. I hope everybody's doing well, having a great day and a great life, and everything's just going beautifully for you. And of course, as always, and most importantly, everybody, keep on growing. Bye bye.